Amen. It's great to be here on Purim, and we are going to look today at the drash called Tetzaveh, which means you shall command. The context is command the sons of Israel that they shall go out in that command. And we're going to be looking at the different passages from Exodus chapter 27, Ezekiel chapter 43, and the Brit Harashah of Hebrews 13. And we're going to go straight into that now. So let's read, actually starting there, set it up, the priesthood under that of Aaron. It says there in chapter 28, you are to call your brother Aaron and his sons to come from among the people of Israel to you so that they could serve me as Kohanim, or priests. Aaron and his son Nadav, Avihu, Eleazar, and Itamar. You are to make your brother Aaron garments set apart for serving God, expressing dignity and splendor. Speak to all the craftsmen to whom I have given the spirit of wisdom, and have them make Aaron's garments to set him apart for me so that he can serve, that he can worship, so he can be there part of fellowship with me in the office of Kohanim. Aaron and his sons Nadab, Abihu, Eleazar, Itamar formed the initial priesthood. Only descendants of Aaron could become priests, and only priests could minister to Adonai in the tabernacle, then later in the temple. The priesthood was descended from Aaron through Levi, who is the son of Yaakov, who is the son of Yitzhak, who is the son of Abraham. The priesthood in the Tanakh is referred to as being the Levitical priesthood. The Levitical priests were to serve to the Lord, worship the Lord, in two main ways. The first way is they were to offer sacrifices to the Lord on the bronze altar that stood outside the holy place and the Holy of Holies, out there in the courtyard, and there on the bronze altar they were to sacrifice animals to atone for the sins of the nation of Israel and the righteous amongst the nations. It says in chapter 29, verses 38 to 39, you can read that yourself, that they had a morning sacrifice and an evening sacrifice that was done for the whole nation. Later, a noonday sacrifice was added in there. The first sacrifice was before they started all the other sacrifices, the priest did the morning sacrifice, which was done at 9 o'clock in the morning. And then that was done for the whole nation, substitution, symbolic representative for the whole nation. And then they stopped at noontime and they did another sacrifice there and went all the way through all the other different sacrifices. The last sacrifice of the day was the evening sacrifice, again done as atonement of sins, forgiveness of sins for the nation of Israel and the righteous amongst the nations, and that was at 3 o'clock. It's very interesting that Yeshua the Messiah goes up on that stake, that tree, that cross, at 9 o'clock in the morning. Signs and wonders are fulfilled at noontime, and then he dies and is taken off the cross at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. He fulfills the morning, the noon, and the evening sacrifice by his once-for-all sacrifice. The priests' sacrifice and worship were done there as a substitution and representative for all the people, which is exactly what Yeshua later did. Note that the bronze altar is outside in the courtyard, and that had to be there and done first, so then the priests are purified so they can go into the holy place and offer prayer and praise and worship on the golden altar of incense that stood in the holy place right before the veil that separated the Holy of Holies before the presence of God, which then brings us to their second reason of doing that of worship, and that is to offer up worship to Adonai in the holy place. Now having been saved, redeemed, having sins forgiven in the outer court, now coming in closer, lighting the menorah lamp, taking the food of the table of showbread, and most importantly, offering up prayer and praise and worship and incense on the golden altar of incense that stood before the veil. As it says there, Exodus chapter 30, Aaron will burn fragrant incense on it, that is the altar of incense, as a pleasing aroma every morning. He is to burn it when he prepares the lamps, that's that seven-branch menorah that stands there in the holy place. Aaron is also burn it when he lights the lamps at dusk in the evening sacrifice. This is the regular burning of incense before Adonai throughout all your generations. Now, Exodus chapter 27, verse 20 tells us that all of Israel was to contribute to this by bringing anointing oil to them that they would then use in the holy place, in the menorah, lighting the menorah in both the Mishkan, the tabernacle, and then later the temple. Exodus 29 also tells us that that anointing oil was then used to also anoint the priests to separate them for their office. Yet much of this Parashah Tetzaveh focuses on the priest's clothing in the God-approved ways. We don't just come in our old rags, we come presented ourselves to God. First of all, it talks about the ephod, and by tradition, that was made by the same material as the veil in the tabernacle and in the temple. The gold was also used in there as well. The breastplate that stood on the priest with the 12 stones representing the 12 tribes of Israel, and then the two stones on the shoulders, that of the Urim or the lights, and the Thummim, that of perfections. The robe of the ephod in blue with the bells and the pomegranates hanging on it. For many years, people didn't quite understand how that was, but in a recent discovery in the city of David, where they were doing the diggings there, they found one of the little bells, and I have a picture of it there for you. Very small, but there's a bell inside it, so it looks like a pomegranate on the outside, and inside there's a bell to ring as they walk, dangling as they go along. It talks about the head covering, where there's going to be a plate that declares holiness to the Lord over the mind, like the helmet of salvation, you might say. And those who know Rav Shaul's commands in Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 to 18, about putting on that spiritual armor, can see here the roots of that spiritual coverings that he was talking about. I want to make a point here that the rabbis are not Levitical priests. They are not necessarily descendants of the Aaronic priesthood. They have to be Levites to be a Levitical priesthood. Any Jew can become a rabbi with the approved rabbinical training. The focus for rabbis is actually on halakha, how to live out the Torah and the Tanakh into today's world. So it's more of a legal focus. One rabbi joked with him once, he said, we're more of a lawyer than what we are anything else. So we want to just leave that there and quickly go into the Haftarah. The tabernacle is later replaced by the temple. Interesting in the scriptures, Adonai only ever asked for the Mishkan, the tabernacle, a humble house to dwell in the midst of his people. Adonai never asked for a temple to be built on a hill. Kings need temples for their egos. The sons of Israel sadly broke Torah. The priests sadly broke the rules of the temple and the sacrifices. And so Adonai allows the Babylonians to come in to destroy the temple, and his people are sent off into exile into Babylon. Ezekiel is writing this passage here, and he writes his book from the Babylonian exile, and he prophesies from chapter 40 through to the end of his book that the temple would be rebuilt. The priest would be again be restored, and sacrifices and worship will again happen in God's house. And this prophecy was fulfilled. Praise God for that. But it brings us into the new covenant times with the second temple. Sad thing is, in the second temple was also destroyed by the Romans in the year 70 of the common era. Since then, for the past 2,000 years, there's been no temple, no active priesthood, and no regular blood sacrifice to be offered. No blood on the altar for 2,000 years. What is the answer? Well, Rabbinic Judaism came up very early with three things: that of doing mitzvah, of good deeds, that of tzedakah, of giving to the poor, and that of siddur, reading the prayer book, which has a lot of scripture in it, just like we do in our liturgical service, and all done while facing Jerusalem and the temple to remember the past sacrifices. Good idea, but not sufficient. Adonai has a better plan. And that's where Yeshua comes in, and we go there into the Brit Hadashah reading of Hebrews chapter 13, which is part of the Celebrate Messiah reading list within there. Hebrews is written to Messianic Jews scattered around the diaspora, encouraging them and even us today that we have found the true high priest, which is Yeshua, the Messiah. The writer of Hebrews actually lays out 12 different specific aspects of how the new covenant and how Yeshua is far superior to the older covenants, built on but superior than. And in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 10, part of our Brit Hadashah reading, it says that we have an altar from which those who serve in the tabernacle, that is the priests, have no right to eat from, because it's not theirs, it's above that. That's because Yeshua the Messiah is God. His sacrifice on that cruel Roman cross 2,000 years ago atoned for and forgave the sin not just of the Jewish people, and like the Levitical priesthood did, but of all humanity. Yeshua the Messiah, Emmanuel, God with us, transcends the Levitical priesthood, goes above them and their offerings to now not just atone for one group, but now for the entire world, even of creation. I want to encourage you to read later Hebrews chapter 7. And it shows there that Yeshua has an eternal priesthood that transcends the Levitical priesthood by the order of, or the example of, one called Melchizedek. Hebrews points out that Levi tithed to Melchizedek, and the Levitical priesthood blesses Melchizedek as being the high priest. Yeshua, the Messiah, is God. You have to think the triunity here. He's not subjected to the limitations and failures of the Levitical priesthood. Yeshua is the creator. Although born through a human, yet conceived by the Ruach Adonai, therefore he is perfect, 100% human, but also 100% God. Yeshua is not a created being. He's not tainted by sin. He does not offer up animal sacrifices that are also tainted by sin. He did not offer up blood for forgiveness of sin on a mercy seat in an earthly tabernacle or temple, a model of that which is the real in heaven, but he himself offered up his own perfect, pure blood on that of the heavenly mercy seat, in that heavenly tabernacle, the real tabernacle, not the model, but the real. His atonement, his forgiveness of sin now is able to cover the entire of creation, covering all humanity. And now Jew and non-Jew, Jew and Gentile can now be one in Messiah, bringing ultimate worship into the very presence of Adonai in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 4, so that we can boldly approach that throne of grace. That's why Yeshua, the Messiah, is the great high priest, the Kohen HaGadol Me'od, above that of Levitical priesthood. That's what it says there in Hebrews chapter 7, verse 22. How much better is the covenant which Yeshua has become the guarantor. Moreover, the present Kohanim, they're many in number because they're prevented by death from continuing office. So there has to be many of them. But because Yeshua lives forever, his position as Kohen, priest, does not pass on to someone else. And consequently, he is totally able to save those who approach God through him, since he is alive forever. And he's able, forever able, to intercede on our behalf. Why? Because he is Adonai. This, it says there, is the kind of Kohen Gadol that meets our needs, holy, without evil, without stain, set apart from sinners, and raised higher than the heavens. One who does not have the daily necessity, like the other Kohen Gadol, of offering up sacrifices, first for their own sin, and then for those of other people. Because he offered one sacrifice once for all by offering himself. That's why a temple's no longer needed. Because the one ultimate sacrifice of the Kohen who transcends above the Levitical priesthood has done it once for all humanity. And in closing, we can say here that final verse there out of our reading today, Hebrews chapter 13, verse 15 to 16. Through him, that is Yeshua. Therefore, let us continually offer God a sacrifice of praise. That is the fruit of our lips that acknowledges his name. That's why we keep saying Yeshua, who at Adonai. He is the Messiah, he is God. But do not forget to do good and share him with others, for such sacrifices God is well pleased. We pray, Adonai, you'd let this word come alive in our heart that we could live it out and acknowledge you as being the Messiah, the fruit of our lips. Amen. God bless you. Hand it back to Rabbi Lawrence. Amen.